I guess we can get started. I'd like to thank Alexei for inviting me to talk to you guys. It was quite a nice experience to meet up with him in the Beak Coffee House, which I can also recommend. Great pour overs in the East Bay, right next to Rockridge Bart. I'm there just about every morning. So I had overheard Alexei talking about organizing a Scala conference, and I perked up my ears and introduced myself, and he said, "We have Scala people who I'm sure would be fascinated to learn about Erlang," so I was happy to volunteer some time to tell you about it. So there's going to be a chance to ask some questions. This is going to be a little bit longer talk than the last one. It'll last about 45 minutes, and then there'll be a 15-minute Q&A period. So my name is Stephen Grady. I'm a senior architect with Erlang Solutions. That's the premier Erlang consulting company. I've been with the company about 6 months. The company's been around for many years. They are primarily a European presence, but we're starting to expand into the into the Americas. Mark Sugiyama and I are the two engineers in the in North America for Erlang, and luckily we're both in the Bay Area. You may have heard about Erlang in a couple of different ways. They made the news a few months ago when WhatsApp was purchased by Facebook for $19 billion. That is a company with 55 employees total, of which about a third of them were engineers working on the back end, and they did all their work in Erlang, and they managed to capture a pretty large market segment, and so people were suddenly very interested in this, and that ratio of engineer to billion was intriguing to people. The other reason you might know about it, particularly as Scala folks, is that you know that it's one of the earlier functional programs that programming languages that established a presence and an interest in, from people. So I'm going to go through this talk a little bit quickly. This is basically an introduction to the language in general, with a focus on some of the elements that might relate to Scala programmers, distributed programming and concurrency in particular. So I apologize now if I'm going pretty fast, but I've got about 40 slides to get through. So Erlang started as a project by Ericsson, and in fact, they still are the ones that develop the software and distribute it. It is open sourced, but it's under their control. They're the ones who produce it. It was created originally to solve telecom problems, because Ericsson is a telecommunications company. The telecom systems of 20 years ago were particularly complex, but they were not allowed to have any downtime. They needed to be scalable, they needed to be maintainable, and it was important to be distributed in particular, because if you have your machine that's handling lots and lots of phone calls and it goes down, you don't want everyone's phone calls to fail. But meanwhile, they needed to develop new features quickly. And so some folks with Ericsson created a new language called Erlang to address this. So the ancestors of Erlang included had a kind of a complex history. It was influenced by a variety of languages. On the concurrent side, Ada and Modula and Chill. On the functional side, ML and Miranda. This was essentially pre-Haskell. And logical languages like Prolog, which in particular it took its syntax from. So I'm going to talk about various parts to Erlang, the declarative elements, how it does concurrency and its approach, what makes it a particularly robust language, because you often hear discussions about how Erlang systems generally don't go down, and that's as a whole, any given part might go down, how the distributed systems work, how the hot code loading works in particular, which is pretty distinctive to Erlang, how it deals with multi-core support, and OTP, the Open Telecom Platform, which is basically all of the libraries and frameworks that come along with it that are not the language itself. So let's start with the basic syntax and roughly what the language itself is. So it is a declarative language. It's a functional programming language. You guys are pretty familiar with functional programming, I imagine. And it's got a high abstraction level. Pattern matching is key to it. By the way, I have a small background in Scala. I've done a little bit of Scala programming a few years ago, and so anything I speak will be not true, but let's pretend it is. So pattern matching case classes are somewhat similar to the pattern matching, which is used all over the place in Erlang. And it generally you get very concise, readable programs. So for instance, let's suppose you wanted to write a factorial function, because this is the canonical example you always give when talking about functional programming and recursion. And so your mathematical expression of it might look familiar. And so the implementation is almost a direct transliteration of that. This code is actually a complete module. If you stuck this into a file and compiled it with the Erlang compiler, that's all you need. So it's declaring that there is a module called ex1, example one. It exports one function called factorial. The factorial function has two versions, and it does pattern matching effectively to say, is this a zero or is it not a zero? And if it's not a zero, then let's return n times factorial of n minus one. So there's a couple of things about this. It's, like I said, it's expressive, it's concise. It's not a difficult language, but it is very different. I mean, I'm sure all of this this syntax looks quite unusual to you if you come from a Java or Scala background or pretty much any of the C-derived languages that have lots of open curlies and closed curlies, hopefully. So in this case, functions are defined with arrows. Phrases of a function are terminated with semicolons, and complete definitions are terminated with periods. Variables are capitalized, which is particularly unusual. Again, that's one of the key things that comes from Prolog. Also, it has no pointers. There's also no mutable values. So in even as pure a functional language like Haskell has mvars and such, but Erlang has literally no mutable variables whatsoever. There is a way to have mutable data, but it's not based on any form of variable that you can change. Erlang has support for higher order functions. Also, I'll point out one other thing which is interesting about this example. There's no case for factorial when n is less than zero. And that's actually intentional, and I'm gonna come back to that. If you want to compile it, you can do this from inside the Erlang interpreter. So you just say C compile the name of the module, and then you can just invoke it with module colon function argument. Here's another example. This is a quicksort function. Actually, not the true quicksort if you're going to be pedantic about it, but a nice concise implementation of a quicksort that uses list comprehensions. I believe there's a rough equivalent in Scala. And so this is basically saying the thing highlighted is a list comprehension. And what it's saying is, let's take all the objects y from the list called rest, where y is greater than first. Rest and first come from pattern matching, where it says a list consists of the first element and the rest of the elements. Again, you can simply compile it, and you would get and then be able to invoke the function. I should mention that, I think I forgot to mention this, Erlang is dynamically typed, a key difference from Scala. So this function will work as long as comparisons work, you know, less than or equal, and you pass in a list. Another interesting, relatively unique element of Erlang is the fact that it has support for bit syntax, and this is particularly useful when dealing with network protocols, as in this example, where the first line, or rather the first expression which starts with these less than's and goes all the way to equals segment, is simply an assignment from the segment, which would be a binary that contains a TCP packet, and it puts it into all the individual variables. So there, after that line, source port is a variable of 16 bits, destination port is a variable of 16 bits. And then even the flags, which over on the right, say flags colon 8, is an 8-bit segment, that can then be broken down as well into the CWR, ECE, and so forth flags. And so now you have all these variables, and that's in two lines. And that's implemented in the VM, and so it's a very fast match. Okay, so that was kind of the introduction to some of the syntax. Let's talk a little bit about the concurrency of Erlang. So it has either transparent or explicit concurrency, and that means that you can either use functions that will spawn off processes. Processes, by the way, is the Erlang term for essentially a thread. It's roughly the same in that it's extremely lightweight. And so processes, or you can explicitly spawn off new processes, and I'm going to show examples of that. Processes are very lightweight. They can be created in microseconds, and a normal Erlang VM running on a standard host can have millions of CPUs. I had a nice experience, or an interesting experience, when I was taking a class in a framework called Cowboy, which is a very high performance, low memory use HTTP framework. And the teacher was saying, how would you do such and such? And so various people said, here's my solution. And he says, well, that's fine if you've got a million simultaneous connections. But if you have, you know, when you start getting up to 2 or 3 million, that might start being too slow. And I don't know about you guys, but I had never really considered a single HTTP server that could handle, you know, 2 million simultaneous connections. And this is written, the code would be written in a very natural way in Erlang, where each one is its own process, i.e. thread, handling its own input. And the reason it can do that is because Erlang processes are so lightweight. And it's highly scalable. So because you tend to use lots of processes because they are very lightweight, you can then you can scale in various ways. If you're on a multi-core machine, you can get more processes running on the different cores. If you need to get it onto multiple machines, then you can have some of those processes running on those other machines as well. And I'll talk about that more as well. So the basic way that you use concurrency is the spawn function. And so spawn creates a new process. So in this example, we've got a module EX3 that has a function called activity that has three arguments. And so we invoke the spawn function, taking the name of the module, the name of the function, and the three arguments. And we assign the result to PID, a variable that stands for process ID. And that will start a new process running that function. These processes don't, the spawn basically doesn't fail. If there's something wrong with the function, then the new process will fail, but the spawn will just continue. When you have these processes, you communicate in what people have referred to in a variety of contexts as Erlang-style concurrency. So that means that there is no sharing of data, all process intercommunication goes through messages, all of the data is immutable, so that means you never have to deal with locks and mutexes. People have implemented this Erlang-style concurrency in a variety of languages, obviously Akka being the significant one in the Scala world, but it's Erlang is kind of the progenitor of this style. So a few more points about this. So this, by the way, is we've got one process that is going to invoke PID, where PID is the variable pointing to this other process, and it's going to send it a message that says data, 12, 13, which is a tuple of three elements. And the process goes to the other, the message goes to the other process, and the other process is listening with a receive statement saying, if I see a tuple called start, then do something. If I do a stop, do something else. If I see a data XY, which is what this will be, then it's going to do that third case. So all message sending is asynchronous. If you want to block and wait for a response, what you do is you make sure that it's written so that the receiver sends a message back to you. And then you wait, so you do your send, and then you do your own receive. So you have to do explicit synchronization. Generally speaking, you actually don't want to block very often in good Erlang code, and I'll talk about that later. So the asynchronous by default model is a kind of a key element of the design and philosophy. By the way, if you send a message to a non-existent process, it just gets thrown away, so you don't get errors if something's gone, which also means if you want to know that it didn't get received, then you are going to need to have a message that notifies you if it was received or not. And finally, if the receiving process is not ready to receive it, for instance, suppose I sent a message foo to that PID and it's sitting in that receive, that message will just sit in its mailbox. And so later it might do a different receive where it says, did anyone send me the foo message? So that has its own implications for how you design Erlang code. Okay, so let's talk about what makes Erlang robust. So there's a few elements. First of all, it's simple and consistent. Simple and consistent error recovery. The error recovery approach is standardized, and I'm going to be talking about that quite a bit, and that's the key is the idea of supervision hierarchies. And so let me step back for a second. The reason why Erlang has almost all of the features it has is because it was designed to be robust. This idea that you can't have your telephone system go down leads to, well, what if various things? What if the system has a crash. Okay, well, let's make sure we have multiple machines so that something can pick up if the other one fails. What if the programmer writes a bug? Well, let's make sure that we can recover from that case cleanly, and ideally, let's recover in a way that's invisible to anybody externally. What if we need a new feature? Let's make sure that we can add new code without bringing the system down, and so forth. So this is a particularly distinctive and important element of the, technically it's not the language, it's the libraries that come with the language called OTP. The idea is that, as with the previous slides, these yellow circles represent processes. And the processes are going to be communicating or not, but one of the key questions is, if the process that's part of the system crashes, how what are we going to do about it? And the answer is you make sure that the other processes or at least one other process knows about that. So what you can do is you can create links between processes. And when you create a link between process A and process B, then A will now be notified if B crashes, and B will be notified if A crashes. And so you can do this by either invoking a particular function when you create the process called spawn link, or you can create the link after the fact. The existence of spawn link is important because it means that you can atomically create and link a process in one statement. The handling of the links, again, is completely inside the Erlang VM. So the idea is that if one of these processes crashes, then it will send an exit message to all the other processes that are linked with. So in that case, the process that crashed was linked to one, but that other one was linked to more, and so those crashes will propagate. And then the termination will propagate to all of the processes. There's another approach, which is that you can trap the failure of a process. And so in this case, we'll say that we're going to catch process failures. So when that one crashes, the various processes that are not catching things crash, but this one says, wait a minute, if I instead want to receive a message, and so it uses its receive function to say, if I ever get an exit, tell me which PID, which process ID it is, and then we can figure out what we're going to do about it. And that idea is the basis, essentially, for the robustness of Erlang, because what you can do with these linked processes is create a robust system by layering the various kinds of processes. So in particular, what you have is two kinds of processes, supervisors and workers. And the supervisor's job is to just watch the workers, and if they crash, to do something. The workers can do whatever you want. They can be HTTP handlers, they can be doing CPU calculations, what have you. And the concept is that if a process crashes, then probably something went bad, went wrong. We don't know what it was. And rather than trying to recover directly, let's just restart that process with a known state. Because a lot of bugs end up being effectively ephemeral in that they're due to something. It might be a weird race condition. It might be bad data coming from somewhere. It might be a bug in some other part of the code that's unsanitized data. And so if you can just restart your worker, then you can, by getting it back into a known state, you can quite likely pick up from where you left off. This works particularly well. There's plenty of anecdotes in the Erlang community about people who have developed relatively complex systems. They'd heard about this, and maybe were a little bit new to Erlang, and so they hadn't necessarily done all the things they should have in terms of setting up monitoring. But then they said, hey, this is great. My system was working just fine. And then they eventually think to check their logs, and they find that there's been workers that have been crashing, you know, every hour for months, but the functionality of the system didn't change at all. I read another anecdote today, actually, that React, which is a database built on top of Erlang, a distributed database, somebody was testing React among other databases, and they wanted to say, well, what are the edge cases? With the various distributed database systems, what happens when you kill off a node? And they were getting confused because when the React host was killed, it kind of dipped performance-wise briefly and then popped back up, and everything was fine. And it's like there was no real evidence that anything had gone wrong. And again, that's because the model is always, things might fail, but let's just recognize it, let's log it, let's restart. So the next thing is that because of the Erlang-style model of actors, and sending data around rather than sharing data between threads, it means that you don't actually need to do anything particularly different when you decide that you want to scale out to multiple machines, because you're just sending data around. And so as a result, you can get very clean distribution. Also, the VM and the language support the idea of sending a message to a remote host as easily as sending to another process on the same host or in the same node. And so you can explicitly set up your distribution, or you can do it implicitly by basically saying, send a message to this process wherever it is, I don't care. And the runtime system is network aware, so it knows when new nodes connect. You can find out a list of nodes and things like that as, again, part of the basic language. So the basic way this works is you might have a couple of processes running on one node, A and B. And then if A wants to send a message to B, it just says B, bang, whatever the message is. If it wants to send a message to C, it does exactly the same thing. But this time, because the runtime system knows that C is on a different host, it says, let me handle this. I'm going to stick onto the network. I'm going to serialize the message. And then when it gets received on the other side, it gets deserialized. But it's completely transparent. And there are various libraries that come with Erlang to do, that are built on top of this basic model for doing RPC, parallel mapping, and so forth. Another feature of Erlang that is really stands out, although I'm going to give some caveats to how useful it is the idea of hot code loading. And again, this was developed in the environment where you have your telecommunication switch, you need to have some new functionality, but you don't want to interrupt anything, including the existing calls. So the idea is, suppose that you have some module with your code, and you've got version 1, and you've got a process that is running version 1. And then you say, wait a minute, we need new functionality. Let's develop version 2. So what I mean when I say the process is running version 1 is it's probably in a loop. It's sitting there saying, am I receiving a message? Oh, I've got a message, let me handle it. Great, now let's go back to the top and receive another message. And so that loop is presumably running relatively often as it's dealing with whatever's coming in. And but when we've brought in version 2, we've now got a new module that's also part of the VM at the same time as the old one is. And so if we ever create a new process for that for that code, it will use version 2. So now you've got version 2 with one process running its code, and you've got old version 1 with one process running its code. But once version 2 is in place, when version 1 gets back to the top of its loop, it can basically say, all right, I want to use tail recursion to invoke my function again. And when it looks up what my function is, it's going to be the version 2 one. So the top of the loop is just going to keep on going. So it's like version 1, version 1, version 1, version 1, version 2, version 2, version 2. And the process never stopped, and now it's running the new code. It does mean that your code has to be structured the right way to take advantage of this, but that comes, again, standard with OTP, these standard libraries. Let me give you, tell you another anecdote of something. I found this on YouTube a few months ago. I just found it delightful. Someone, as a way of demonstrating this concept of hot code swapping, had decided to implement a flight controller in a quadcopter drone, so it was like sitting on their table, and he had deliberately introduced a bug so you could watch the quadcopter drone going, as it was supposed to be stable in flight, but it wasn't stable. And then he fixed the bug, uploaded it, and the quadcopter went, and it just became stable. So this was upgrading the code of an in-flight vehicle. So that's, again, something that I'm not sure I would trust very much in other languages. All that being said, oh, by the way, there's a garbage collection of the modules themselves. So once there's no more processes talking to version 1, version 1 will just go away. All that being said, I said that there was a bit of a caveat, and that is, if you are, depending on the style of system you're developing, if you're creating, say, a web scale backend and you've got multiple servers, you need to have an entire host be able to go down and the other hosts take over. And if you've got that in place correctly, then if you just kill the Erlang VM without bothering to do any of this hot code swapping, then presumably your functionality will do the right thing and spread the workload to the other machines, and then you can just copy in your new code, artist it or what have you, and then start it up again. And then if you've, again, you've written your code correctly, it's all going to migrate back as appropriate. So despite the cleverness of hot code swapping, I've never actually used it in a project, because it was because all the systems I've worked on have had to been had to be robust enough that they could deal with shutting this system down or shutting a given VM down. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about multi-core support. This is relatively new in the sense that it's a few years old as opposed to 20 years old, like most of Erlang. The key idea is that it provides linear scalability out of the box. And what that means essentially is if you have a standardly written Erlang application that has, let's say, a few hundred or a few thousand threads, or maybe a few million if you've ended up being ambitious and have scalability going on, then when you put it on a machine with more CPUs, those processes will just go to the various cores. And it's you watch your CPU and you went from 100% to 700%. I have never spent any particular time on Erlang systems figuring out how to take advantage of this of the multiple cores. It just happens. And that's again because of this the approach to concurrency it uses, where we don't have to worry about locking and there's not scalability issues that come up with, oh, now you've got more contention for the locks, etc. Of course, the inside the VM, there's plenty of that stuff going on, but that's where all of the engineering focus has been in the development of Erlang. Let's see, is there anything else I want to say? Not about this. I do want to talk about how it works, though, and this is actually a key distinction between the Erlang VM and the JVM, or some of the JVMs. So the idea is that you have every process every core gets its own scheduler. How about that? And each scheduler maintains its own run queue, and there's also, so the processes just go to whatever scheduler is currently available. And so the idea is that, again, you have more cores, then you just get more schedulers, and each scheduler is running on its own core, and when there's something new to run, it runs it. The distinction between this and the JVM is the garbage collection. So every process has its own garbage collection, essentially independent of all the other ones. There's a little bit of a lie in that, but let's say that that's basically true. What the heck's going on? And what that means is that processes that are dealing with a small, if you have lots and lots of processes that each are dealing with a relatively small amount of data, and again, there isn't shared data, so the context is going to be constrained to that single process, the GC is going to run very quickly. And you basically don't get any stop the world, we need to do garbage collection. You can, of course, have garbage collection issues if for some reason your code is written poorly or you and otherwise want to optimize things. But the nice thing is that when you have those problems, what it means is you're not garbage collecting enough and you see your memory usage go up. And that means you can anticipate a problem as opposed to waiting for something bad to happen. In the, a more common story in the JVM world is that the garbage collection is suddenly very slow and now you're not getting the performance you were expecting, but you find out after the fact rather than before it. Okay, so let me talk about OTP briefly because it's actually a pretty significant part of the what you get when you buy into Erlang. So technically, OTP is the entire Erlang distribution. So when you download Erlang, what you're really downloading is OTP, and Erlang, the compiler and the interpreter, comes with it. It was open sourced 16 years ago. The latest version is 17.3, and it is considered stable. It has a lot of different libraries, including things for XML, SNMP, SSL, and so forth. Of course, nothing compares to the number of Java libraries. I'm not going to say we compete there, but it's pretty close to a batteries included kind of a distribution. One of the key elements of OTP is that design principles are implemented as code, essentially. That is to say, if you want to know how to write a good gen server in good Erlang style, a good server in good Erlang style, one that listens to not network server, but one that listens to messages and responds to them, rather than figuring out how to write it on your own, you should probably just use the standard gen server, which stands for generic server. And there's generic finite state machines, and and this whole mechanism of saying there's supervisors and workers, you don't have to write any of that yourself. All of those things are supported as libraries, they're standardized, they have been maintained and refined for many years. And so there's just all this stuff. You can pretty much think about the problem you want to solve and not worry about all the details. So when I talk about all these nice things about how Erlang works, that's already been encapsulated in these libraries. It comes with a lot of useful tools. Amnesia is a distributed replicating database. Dialyzer, so I mentioned that Erlang is dynamically typed, or unityped if you prefer, but Dialyzer is an external tool that's not part of the compiler that implements what's called success typing, which is roughly like static typing. It's a little bit looser version of static typing, but basically you can find out if your functions are, if you've got type errors in your code. Observer is a real, it's a graphical interface that provides real-time access to all sorts of things about the Erlang VM, so you can see, you can look at all the processes that exist and what their current state is and how long your message queues are and so forth. EUnit is a unit test framework. There's a documentation framework and so forth. Of course, the entire system comes with, it's fully documented. There's an entire suite of reference documents for everything that comes with it. There's also a suite of user guides that correspond to each of the subsystems, and it's continuing to undergo development. So Ericsson releases a new one, like I say, or if I didn't say, every year, and it continues to get better. So for instance, in the most recent version, they added an entire new data type, which was maps. It used to be that you would use a library to do a to do any kind of map, and now it's part of the language. And other things that came in the most recent one is new optimizations, better Unicode support, entire new language features like named local functions. And so that came out in April, and version 18 will probably come out in April or something of next year. There actually are other implementations of Erlang, by the way. There's including one on Xen, and that implementation is interesting because it's so low level that it can really make use of some good low-level optimizations, and one application that's been implemented on top of that is a software switch that can actually switch 500,000 packets per second, which about the only system out there that can do better than that is written in C and sells for $500,000. And then another nice part about OTP and Erlang is that when you start it up, you get a shell, or you can get a console. You can always get for a default implementation of an Erlang system, you can always get a console by coming in through a network port or through a local pipe, or you can interact with your functions and create new functions on the fly and query your system and debug and turn tracing on and so forth, all with pretty much any Erlang application you write. You don't have to throw anything extra in to get all of that functionality. Let me talk for a minute about Java integration. So the way, if you are writing, because you can use, if for some reason Erlang seems like the right solution, but you have to do some sort of interoperability with Java, the normal way to do it is to, it extends the normal Erlang model, which is you do it by sending messages. So there's a protocol-based interface called J interface. And so for example, if you want to send to Erlang, then you say, here's the node that I want to be, let's call it Bingo, and then we're going to create a mailbox, something so that we can receive and send messages, and then let's send a message to foo at localhost, which is going to be the name of an Erlang node, and what we're going to send is an atom, or an OTP Erlang atom, that consists of the string hello. If you want to receive messages from Erlang, then you can register a name. I didn't talk about registering, but the idea is that processes can either be named or unnamed, or registered or unregistered. If it's unregistered, you actually need a variable that has the process ID, but you can also register a name, and then you can just say, I want to send this to, for instance, the print server process. So in this case, we can register a name called server, and then we say mbox.receive, and then that's going to return with some object when it comes back, and then you can use instance of to determine what type it is. There's plenty of other serialization frameworks, however, if you don't like that, it comes with ASN.1, there's JSON, message pack, protocol buffers, XML, all these parsers and serializers and deserializers. Or you can just go to straight networking and not using serialization. You can, of course, it's very straightforward to do TCP, HTTP, HTTPS, AMQP, 0MQ, SOAP. So I'm going to talk for a couple minutes about various myths of Erlang. So if you have been exposed to Erlang in the community, you might have heard someone say, hey, I wrote my Erlang system in 4 weeks. Yeah, not so much. It's certainly possible to write something in 4 weeks, but if you're going to have a real system, you need to be just like any other development of a robust system, you're going to need to document it, you need to make sure that you know how it's going to be supported, etc. And so all these extra things, you know, they always require work. It's not something, Erlang provides a lot of help for these things, but if you're going to want SMP interfaces, then you need to define your MIB, etc. But you can get your prototyping going very quickly, quicker than just about any other system that I've developed on. Another thing I was saying, like, hey, upgrades during runtime are easy. Well, not so much. You can do it, but it's not really easy. I mean, it's easy if you're going to do simple patches. It's easy if you say, oh, I want to put this new algorithm in, but the state is exactly the same. But if you have to do things that are not backwards compatible, you need to migrate your database schema. If you are suddenly changing the state of your process, remember I talked about that loop which goes back to the top? Well, if the loop is expecting to have a different state in version 2 than version 1, then you need a way of figuring out how to migrate that information. When you're in distributed environments, you have to figure out how to make that, or you have to think, is this going to be transactional or what have you. And of course, you always have to test this kind of thing. And so it's, again, not easy, but it's possible. And it's easier than in many other systems. Another one is the nine nines of availability. So Joe Armstrong, one of the creators of Erlang, actually wrote his PhD thesis about this. And he was able to achieve this by lots and lots of interesting and careful techniques, but it wasn't easy. Mark and I actually worked at a previous company where the engineers joked that they hadn't achieved nine nines, but they had achieved eight eights. So not so much. On the other hand, but it still is pretty darn good. Like there's anecdotes that, like they say, you know, this quote was from Ericsson, that they have a risk that their engineers are not learning how to do field maintenance because the system just works. By the way, to put that in context, nine nines is about 1 second every 30 years, so that's pretty ambitious. But five nines actually is very possible and very common, which is about 5 minutes per year. And you can usually achieve it at the fraction of the effort of what it would take to do the equivalent thing in Java or C. But keep in mind, where do those 5 minutes come from? Well, upgrades are not always smooth, and there's always non-software related issues. If you have power outages and everything's co-located, that can be an issue, and so forth. I wanted to talk for a few minutes about the Erlang best practices. So the first thing, and this was actually one of the first things I learned when I started on Erlang, I don't think I said, I've been doing it for about 7 years, is that you should follow OTP. So I thought, well, gosh, I understand the basics of how do you write a server. Why do I need all this extra library stuff? And then at some point, I figured it out, because I wasn't getting a lot of the functionality that comes for free if you use those libraries. And OTP is not just some engineers throwing it together. This has been refined over and over and over again with lots of feedback from the community. So, you know, imagine take your favorite library and think, how would that be if just about everyone in the community, Scala or what have you, was using it, and they were providing feedback, and we had 20 years of those iterations. So that's where OTP sits. Let it crash is a key one. This was actually has kind of blossomed as the motto of the Erlang community, although it goes back quite a few years. I will say I was, I'm not sure what my reaction was, to discover today that letitcrash.com is actually an Akka site. I kind of feel like it should be an Erlang site, but someone missed the boat on that one. So the concept behind let it crash is essentially, rather than doing defensive programming and checking that you've got that you're getting the answer back than you expect, assume that you've got the correct answer, and assume that things work, and if it doesn't, then let things crash. So this was my example, when I mentioned about the factorial that we didn't check for n is less than zero, that would have crashed if you passed something less than zero. The key is that crashing is not necessarily a bad thing when you're talking about an Erlang-style set of processes and supervisors. So in this example, suppose you have some function that says, let's try something that might fail. So it's bad to just do that if and let's presume that try something which can return OK or an error of some sort. So if you're not looking at the error at all, that's bad, because if it returned an error, you have no idea. And now you've got a state that you don't really understand, because when you tried to do the thing, it didn't, and who knows what happened. A traditional way to do it is, let's make sure we check our errors. So we're going to do case try something of blah, blah, blah. And if it's OK, then great, let's keep going. If it's an error, let's log things and so forth. But the best style is to say OK equals try something. And that is actually doing a pattern match, but the pattern is a constant pattern. So it's going to say, we're going to take the result, and we're going to match it again against OK. And as long as they match, we're fine, and we keep going. If it doesn't, then it's not a bug, but it's a crash. And the VM will effectively crash that process, which will cause maybe exceptions to be handled higher. But really, what's likely in Erlang is that there will be no exception, and the entire process will crash. The supervisor will get notified, because the supervisor is linked to it, and will get this message saying, hey, I just died. And it will log something in your logs, and maybe send other kinds of triggers, and then it'll restart the worker. So, and then the worker is restarted in a known state, and maybe the thing that was not supposed to fail will no longer fail. By the way, supervisors are reasonably intelligent. If they restart something too many times in too short a period, then they will give up, and then they can even fail, and you can have higher level supervisors, which is why it's an entire tree. But generally, it doesn't come to that. Oh, and by the way, if you're thinking, what happens if the top level supervisor crashes? Again, 20 years focused on essentially one piece of code, it does not crash. So given that your code is going to crash anyway, by which I mean you can't guarantee your code is perfect. Even with really strong type checking and so forth, you may have some bugs that are dependent on external circumstances. So allow your code to be written in a way that says, OK, we might crash sometimes. Let's make sure we catch and deal with it. Another thing is that if you are going to let things crash, you don't want much to crash. So this is another part of how Erlang has a nice approach, where you use lots of processes that each do small things, because if that process crashes, only that small set of things is affected. So for example, if you're dealing with HTTP requests and each request is in its own process, if one HTTP request fails for some reason, it won't affect any of the others, because that process will crash, but all the other million processes won't. And then you let them reset to a known state, because again, if this is an important worker, then let's get it going again, and let's get it going maybe in the initial state it started with, and then it's going to be nice and clean again. But of course, you need to make sure that the errors that do happen are logged, and then you can look at the logs later, and you can debug it maybe the next day rather than at 3 in the morning on a Saturday. But you do want to watch out for thrashing, which is, if something is crashing a lot, your system might spend more time dealing with that and restarting it. So you do have to be aware of your system. You don't simply want to let all crashing systems slide because, hey, your system was working reasonably well, because you can have consequences of that. But the basic model is let it crash and then let it clean up. Yeah, but that would be a longer motto. So another best practice is basically synchronization in a distributed system is hard. So you've got race conditions. You don't have race conditions in terms of threads and shared data structures, but you can. If I'm sending a message and I'm expecting that the two nodes, my node and the other node, have the same view of the data, but meanwhile something comes in and maybe it's going in the opposite direction, you may have a bug that's due to a race condition. Mirroring the data that says, I'm relying on the fact that I'm trying to scale up my workload. I'm going to rely on the fact that that other machine has exactly the same data I have, and we're going to make sure we send those messages, but there's fractions of time when it's not the same. And this is why you have the CAP theorem, right? Consistency, availability, and partitioning are not all possible to satisfy. So don't try. If to the extent you can, use asynchronous messages. So you send your data without assuming that you're going to get that you're synchronized on the result, or that the other guy has the same data that you do. And then the receiver should probably check and say, wait a minute, you made an assumption about my data that's not currently true, so let me notify you. And they have a way of getting back in sync. This is not a universal solution. But it can simplify a lot of problems where it's not so critical. Like, you may not want this for certain banking or flight navigation and such, but if you're dealing with a chat system on a massive social network and you've got one time in a million something is not quite right, it's a lot better than trying to pay the cost of having everything synchronized all the time. But when you have a distributed system, there's lots and lots of messages going back and forth, and your behavior can be a nice proxy for the behavior in a system like that is, are my message queues too long? Are they building up? Are the receivers not actually dealing with the messages, so the queues are getting longer and longer? And so if you can look at your message queues, you can get a pretty good sense of, am I sending too many messages? Am I sending messages that are taking too long to handle, and so forth? Another key concept is the idea of dynamic scalability. It's pretty common these days for people to write systems that say, oh, we can scale this out horizontally, so we can do 10 hosts now. Oh, what happens when 10 hosts isn't enough? All right, well, let's figure out when we're gonna bring it down, reconfigure, et cetera. But you don't wanna bring things down, right? That's the Erlang world. So instead, you need to be able to expand your capacity dynamically. You may want to contract your capacity. If you're using EC2 instances or something, then you don't want to be paying as much money. It's like, yeah, we're idle for most of the evening because we're only running in North America. All right, let's use fewer instances during that period. But both of these problems are a little bit tricky because hot caches. If your cache is cold, which is always going to be in a new system, then the new host may not be able to handle the workload that would be shoved onto it when it takes over, say, 10% of your entire workload. Similarly, if you have a host that goes down and all the workload migrates back to the smaller set of machines, the cache for those parts is not necessarily hot. And so you have to be careful in both directions. But luckily, there are tools to help. I mentioned earlier there's this distributed database called React that comes from the company Basho. It's open source. And it's actually a very nice tool because not only does it do all this stuff nicely, but it's actually written as an extensible framework so you can use it for doing dynamic scalability of things that's not about databases. For instance, if you want to have a chat system and you say, oh, I want to be able to add new nodes that have new rooms, and then it'll just find the new hosts, and there's a way that it trickles the work over and so forth. Use processes freely. If you think you want a new process or something, go ahead and give it a try. Don't feel like, oh, I can't have too many of these or it's going to cause a problem for the system. That's almost never the case. If you start running into a billion processes, you're probably going too far. But a million processes is absolutely fine. Anytime you've got concurrent activity, the concept that, well, this could be happening while something else is happening. I'm dealing with two HTTP requests at once, use two processes for them. Try to have processes that perform only a single role. So if you've got something that's you've got some of your functionality that needs to be a client to some service out there and another one that needs to be a service to various clients out there, probably don't have the same process for that. Just split them into two. Again, that relates in part to the let it crash philosophy, so if one thing fails, you don't bring too much down. And just as a matter of coding, keep that main loop of the process in one module. Don't have it jump all over the place doing receives and blocking waits in one bit of code, and over here it's jumping in a function where it's doing blocking waits in another bit of code. It's just confusing, and again, the OTP model clarifies that. The way you would do most standard servers, by the way, in Erlang, and using Gen Server, the OTP standard framework for this, is just as callbacks. You have a callback for when you get a message, when you get an asynchronous message, when you've got a call that needs a response, and so forth. You don't actually write the loop yourself at all. Monitoring is key in all of this. We're talking about relatively complex systems. Erlang does not really make an ideal solution when you're talking about small scripts that you might write for various reasons, not the least of which is it's basically, in some sense, an operating system all of its own. I was very miffed to realize a few years ago that you cannot write code that catches signals in Erlang. So I want to catch Control C. You can't do it, which is kind of shocking. You, of course, can do it by extending the system, but it's not part of the language or the VM. But it is very appropriate to larger servers and larger systems that cross multiple machines and so forth. And so the more complex the system, the more transparency is going to be necessary. So you want to be able to find out what's going on. Like the previous talk was giving great examples of what you really want to be seeing. You want to be seeing these events. You want to see them as graphs. You want to get triggers when certain things happen. You want to be able to analyze your historical trends. Am I getting more messages this time or less? You want to be able to see things at the, not just the application level, but the level of the VM itself and what's going on in the hosts and what's going on with the network as a whole. And because in this complex system, there will be failures of various sorts, and the better you can understand what the system looks like in your steady state, as well as in exceptional circumstances, the better you're going to be able to get a handle not just on what's going on, but how to address your design so that you don't keep on having that in the future. And again, there's plenty of tools out there that that can provide really good monitoring, and I'll provide a little plug here that Erlang Solutions sells a tool called Wombat that is specifically for this. It provides great transparency into what's going on within Erlang, but it hooks into the non-Erlang parts of your system as well as other tools out there that are have their own ways of gathering data. I'm going to wrap up here. So there's an Erlang factory every year in San Francisco. They generally happen in March. And so the most recent one in 2014 had all these various participants. There's plenty of ways to find out more information. There's here's a few books that we can recommend. The Programming Erlang by Joe Armstrong, who created the language. Erlang Programming, one of the authors, Francesco Cesarini, is my boss and the founder of Erlang Solutions. And Erlang and OTP in Action kind of focuses on the OTP side of things. But if you're looking for more, there's a variety of others. And so if you want to do something interesting, you can try it out and go to erlang.org and download it. And when you finish installing it, type Erl and you're in your prompt, and you can type hello++world and you get a result. If you want to learn it, then you can, among other things, go to learnyousomeerlang.com. Thanks very much. Are there questions? Yes?
Could you expand more about garbage collection, especially lines were going up as you were talking about it, and I missed it?
Sure. What I was saying was that that was the interesting lighting fiasco of 2014. The idea in garbage collection in Erlang is that each process, and again you have millions of them, is garbage collected separately. And so what that means is that normally a single process, because of the idea of isolation and so forth, probably doesn't have a lot of data, so it can be garbage collected very quickly. And so you never see a stop the world garbage collection event. What you see is, if the only real problem you'll see if your code is not written to appropriately deal with the garbage collection behavior of Erlang, is that your memory will start building up because you've still got a handle on memory that's not actually considered garbage by the VM. And the nice thing about that is you can see that problem happening before it actually becomes a real problem. In other words, if you watch your memory go up, you can say, uh-oh, if we reach a gigabyte, there's something wrong, but you can see that when you're at a quarter gigabyte. As opposed to, say, a stop the world event in a typical JVM experience where the uh-oh moment is when it's already too late because it's suddenly been not reacting for a few seconds and your plane is starting to fall. Does that answer your question?
Is there a way to know ahead of time when garbage collection
happens?
How is that done?
The question was, can you find out whether garbage collection is going to happen ahead of time? There's no notification beforehand, but there's quite a few hooks into it. So you can express various controls of the garbage collection parameters themselves. But yeah, you don't get an opportunity to intercede before it happens. Yeah?
In the distributed case for remote processes, how much control do I have over where everything is? And how much does Erlang keep track of it for me?
The question is whether, when you're doing distributed management, how much control you have over it. You have up to complete control. So you can express that you want a particular, as an example, there's an RPC mechanism where you can say, I want to have this node run this function, or you can say, I want to send a message to this node, or you can just say, I want to, one process can say, I'm going to register myself as the global, print server was my example before, and then somebody else can say, okay, I'm going to send a message to the print server. I mentioned parallel maps, so you could, if you had 50 machines and you wanted to run the same function on all of them, by default, you can just say pmap and then give the function, it'll be sent to all of them, and then the results will come back in a list. So you can have as much or as little explicit control as you want. Yeah, in the back?
You said there was some mechanism for handling some sort of mutable state
The question is about how you do mutable state in Erlang. So there's something called ETS, the Erlang term system, and it's a very high performance key value storage where the values are tuples. And so it's got, along with the idea of saying, I want to store this value with this key and then being able to look it up very quickly, you can also do pattern matching and some other higher level constructs. And that term storage is available potentially to all processes. When you create it, you might create it so that only your process can see it. So in other words, you have some visibility control on it, but one of the ways you can use it is to say, I'm going to stick this data in here so that other processes can see it. Now, of course, at that point, you're not going to have any you're not going to have memory corruption as a result of multiple access to it, because the VM controls that, so it's all transactional. But you do need to be aware that if you might be looking at a value and right after you look at it, someone can change it. Yes?
Is there any Akka Erlang interoperability?
Is there Akka Erlang interoperability? So like I say, I have had very little experience with Scala itself, much less Akka. I literally have never used Akka. The closest I've come is tried to read about it a little bit. It's actually pretty impressive how much of the how much they've achieved, in particularly in a language that is not designed for it from scratch. I would be surprised if there weren't somebody had done it. I haven't looked into it. Obviously, like I say, you can use this J interface to talk to the Java version of things. But if you really want the case classes sent by Scala itself, I don't know how you would do that. Sorry. Yes?
Do you have an opinion on Elixir?
Do I have an opinion on Elixir? Mark actually just taught a class last week in Elixir, and so I've got a little bit of exposure to it. I haven't used it much. I'm glad that it exists, because the main obstacle to Erlang, it seems, for a lot of people has been the syntax, and Elixir has this very nice Ruby-like syntax. For people who don't know, Elixir is a relatively new language developed really over the last year or two that runs on the Erlang VM, and it uses a Ruby-like syntax. But it has access to all of the features of Erlang. Everything I just described is available from Elixir as well. And so it's relatively immature. I wouldn't want to do a production system on it yet. But a lot of people are coming into the Erlang world because they come from Ruby and said, oh, let's try doing this Elixir thing. So that's great. Plus, it has a lot of features that Erlang as a language doesn't have. It's got, I won't go into them, but at one point I went through and tried to figure out what was different and came up with 30 different things, most of which were pretty nice. And I'd think, oh gosh, I wish I had that in Erlang. Like, for instance, so Erlang by default uses lists to store strings, so each character is its own integer, and that's not very fast. There's other ways to do it, but you have to know about them to use the binary storage instead of the standard list of int storage. Elixir does it by default, just as an example. So I'm happy for it, I'm glad you brought it up, because I can say if people were interested in this but just felt like first of all, they want to be on the cutting edge and learn something really new, and they don't like the Erlang syntax, check out Elixir instead. All right, thanks very much.